Prabhupada. In order to advance in spiritual understanding, one has to hear from the authentic sources about spiritual knowledge. One can understand the reality of spiritual life by following strictly regulated principles and by controlling the senses. To have control, it is necessary that one be non-violent and truthful, refraining from stealing, abstaining from sex life, and possess only that which is absolutely necessary for keeping the body and soul together. One should not eat more than necessary. He should not collect more paraphernalia than necessary. He should not talk unnecessarily with common men. And he should not follow the rules and regulations without purpose. He should follow the rules and regulations so that he may actually make advancement. There are 18 qualifications mentioned in Bhagavad Gita, among which is simplicity. One should be without pride, one should not demand unnecessary respect from others, and one should be non-violent. Amanitvam adambatvam aham ahimsa. One should be very tolerant and simple. One should accept the spiritual master and one should control the senses. These are mentioned here in the Bhagavad Gita as well. One should hear from authentic sources how to advance in spiritual life. Such instruction should be taken from the acharya and should be assimilated. It is especially mentioned here, nama sankirtanacha. One should chant the holy names of the Lord, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, either individually or with others. Lord Chaitanya has given special stress to chant these holy names of the Lord as a basic principle of spiritual advancement. Another word used here is arjavena, meaning without diplomacy. A devotee should not make plans out of self-interest. Of course, preachers sometimes have to make some plan to execute the mission of the Lord under proper guidance, but regarding personal self-interest, a devotee should always be without duplicity and he should avoid the company of persons who are not advancing in spiritual life. Another word is Arya. Aryan are persons who are advancing in knowledge of Krishna consciousness as well as in material prosperity. The difference between the Aryans and the non-Aryans, the Sura and Asura, is in their standards of spiritual advancement. Association with persons who are not spiritually advanced is forbidden. Lord Chaitanya advised Asat Sangat Tyaga. One should avoid persons who are attached to temporary. Asat is one who is too materially attached, who is not a devotee of the Lord, and who is too attached to women or enjoying material things. Such a person, according to Vaishnava philosophy, is a persona non grata. A devotee should not be proud of his acquisitions. The symptoms of a devotee are meekness and humility. Although spiritually very advanced, he always remains meek and humble, as Kaviraja Goswami and all other Vaishnavas have taught us by personal example. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu taught that one should be humbler than the grass on the street and more tolerant than the tree. One should not be proud or falsely puffed up. In this way, one will surely advance in spiritual life. Thus ends the Bhaktivedanta purport. So in this verse, wonderful instructions which are very critical for making advancement in spiritual life is being delineated by Lord Kapila. First, devotee should always try to hear about spiritual master and utilize his time in chanting the holy name of the Lord. And then his behavior should be straightforward and not duplicitous, and he should avoid the company of those who are not spiritually advanced. Hearing about the spiritual matters and hearing the name, transcendental names of the Lord will constantly purify our consciousness. right now in this material world, we have a contaminated consciousness. According to Sankhya philosophy, this material body, this system, consists of 24 elements, and the 25th element is a soul in the body, and the 26th factor is the super soul. Out of these 24 elements, you can sum up gross body, then subtle body. Gross body is made up of Panchabhuta, 5 elements. Then there is the 5 tanmatras, taste, smell, touch, etc., 5 of them. Then there is 5 karma indriya, 5 jnana indriya. And then there is manas, buddhi, ahankara. So it totals to 23. Totals to 23. 5, 5, 5, 5, and 3. 23. And the 24th is described as contaminated consciousness. And then there is a soul. Then there is a super soul. So what is this contaminated consciousness? This contaminated consciousness is the soul, just like sun emanates sun rays, light and heat. The soul emanates consciousness, emanates attention, emanates chit. And that chit, that it, the soul that emanates the chit, chit means attention, chit means consciousness. If you see, no dead matter does not emanate, did not generate chetana, does not emanate chitta, consciousness. So Bhagavatam says this 24th element is called chitta. Chitta. Actually, that is, we have, chitta is also described elsewhere as real mind, body, mind, intelligence and ahankara is considered to be the sukshma sharira. And the chitta is considered to be susukshma, even finer. The finest material body is the attention body, is our contaminated consciousness. So when we say, so which is the closest to the soul? Not even ahankara, it is the contaminated consciousness. Consciousness or the attention body. We all have an attention body. Let us say, let's use the word attention body. Gross body, subtle body and attention body. And if we purify our attention body, that is closest to the soul, we get purified. That is called chitta shuddhi. Our chitta should become pure. Our original consciousness is pure, that of the soul. Soul swarupa is pure. But this attention body which we have taken up, this, that is not pure. Why? Because this attention body, for instance, I am this body, when I say, my consciousness is also having that consciousness that I am this body. Body is separate, but I am having a consciousness that I am the body. That awareness that I am this body. That awareness body, that is called the chitta. And this chit is contaminated by I am this body, I am this type of body, this type of person, this type of this thing belong to this society, belong to the material world. All these kind of things that is there, this is called our contaminated consciousness. And we are all living our life of consciousness, isn't it? We are all, our body is assisting our consciousness. Our subtle body is also assisting our consciousness, because rasa is in consciousness. We are all in this material world for rasa. There are two kinds of rasas, lording rasa and serving rasa. Our constitutional rasa is serving rasa. In the material world, everybody is infected, contaminated with the lording rasa. So what does our contaminated consciousness means? A consciousness that wants to lord over, to enjoy independently, that is the contaminated consciousness. And obviously that is ignorance. I am this body, I am independent, I am disconnected from God, I am separated, I am this kind of separatist consciousness is called contaminated consciousness. And the entire world is full of, every living entity is full of this contaminated consciousness. And his original consciousness is hiding behind or dormant, which is what we really are. So, the first instruction here. Okay, so the first task for us, for those who want to spiritually advance, especially having come into a human form, is by hearing about spiritual matters and hearing the holy name of the Lord. Now, this, hearing this about spiritual matters, hearing Bhagavatam, hearing Bhagavad Gita, hearing Bhaktivedanta purports, they are all sounds that are generated from the spiritual platform. They are not ordinary sound. So they carry spiritual energy in them. This spiritual energy, when it comes in contact with our contaminated consciousness, when it comes in contact with our attention, the attention becomes purified. Purified means what? Developing serving mood, developing serving attitude. Contaminated means what? Lording attitude. Purified means serving the Lord. I am the servant of Krishna, I have to serve the Supreme Personality, this is my constitutional position. Awakening that attitude is actually our real rasa. We have forgotten our real rasa. That means what the soul really enjoys is seva. Somehow Maya, because of association with the material energy, Maya has given us an artificial taste to lord over. Is artificial taste. It is not our natural taste. So hearing the spiritual shabda, chanting the holy names of the Lord, which is pregnant with all the potencies of the Lord, Satchit Ananda potencies, our attention becomes purified. The goal of life is to purify our chitta, purify our consciousness, purify our attention body. When our attention becomes purified, then false ego vanishes. False ego is like a ghost. It's a ghost element. Why you compare to ghost? Suddenly ghost comes and disappears. You cannot catch him. He appears and disappears. So similarly, false ego is like that. It appears between you and the material energy and it disappears. And another false ego comes. Another false ego comes. Another false ego. Different false egos are haunting our consciousness. So when we associate with the transcendental sound, then our consciousness becomes pure. When our consciousness becomes pure, automatically we will lose our taste for adopting any associating with false ego. And I am not independent. No more independent thinking, no more independent enjoying. The idea of I am an independent enjoyer, I am idea that I take care of myself, the idea of I am the doer of everything, all those things will vanish with the rise of chit in our pure knowledge in our consciousness body. So therefore, whatever time we have, we should constantly, without wasting any time, be in touch with the transcendental sound, either Prabhupada's books or hearing Hare Krishna Mahamantra. Should not waste any time. What are the other ways of wasting the time? Most of us waste our time by thinking. It's called speculating. We're always thinking. Thinking, how is this, how is that, how is that? No, why do you think? Why do you want to hear? Bhagavatam says, Bhagavad Gita says, how it is, why it is, everything it is. Let me hear. Hearing will bring pure thinking. But thinking in Kali Yuga, by thinking, by speculating, you cannot figure out what is the Param Satya. By hearing, you will get the thinking about Param Satya. So this is very important for us to understand that our path is through hearing. That is why we are not in the path of jnanis. For jnanis, they want to figure out through knowledge everything. If you tell them to chant Hare Krishna also, they'll say, why? But the devotee is faith in the guru, says, chant Hare Krishna this way, this way, this way, don't do this, don't do this. They chant. And then they automatically get free knowledge. Whereas the jnanis get knowledge by jnana prayasa. They have to do a lot of thinking, prayasa, prayasa, prayasa. It's also tapasya. Jnanic path is also tapasya. So they get jnana by jnana tapasya. Jnana prayasa. Devotees don't have jnana prayasa. They only have jnana prayojana. They get the benefit of jnana. Why? Because they are touching the infinite treasure house of jnana, which is the nama of the Lord. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So this is a science. This is how it works. It does not matter who it is. How fallen one is, how bad his consciousness is, all immaterial. If he takes to the instructions of the scriptures, revealed scriptures, to hear the Hare Krishna Mahamantra consistently, non-stop, mala after mala, you'll be shocked the kind of jnana udaya that happens, pure transcendental knowledge that happens. And that is the path. And if that is not happening in us, it simply means that we are also not properly following the path of bhakti. we are also spending most of the time in speculation. We are also doing jnana prayasa. We don't understand Krishna. We don't, our part to understand the knowledge of Krishna consciousness is not jnana prayasa. By Shravanam Kirtanam, by the Kripa of the Lord, Kripa of Guru, the knowledge which is already present, the transcendental knowledge, who we are, what we are, everything is already present in the Shabda. And by hearing that Shabda with devotion, with respect, Shabda is a living Shabda. Living Shabda means every Shabda should be respected. Every living person should be respected. I may not respect this table, but anything living, anything as Chetana, you should respect, isn't it? So similarly, the Shabda should be respected. The way to respect Shabda is to hear Shabda with begging for the mercy of the Shabda to enlighten us. Reading, hearing, you take on Bhaktivedanta purport, you're reading Prabhupada's books, you should pray to the Shabda, to pray to the purport that I may understand you. You will be surprised how the words will speak. The words will speak. They are live words that will speak. And that Shravanam we will get, and that is the most powerful way of enlightenment. It will break all barriers of ignorance very fast, simply by hearing. Now other instructions are given here that we should not associate with those who are materially minded. Because by hearing the transcendental sound, Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavatam, Bhaktivedanta purports, chanting Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, chanting the names of the Lord, and various other processes of deity worship, but all that Prabhupada has introduced, we do all those things to purify our chitta, to purify our attention, to develop the serving attitude in our attention. So we do all these things. Now if you go and associate with people who are having contaminated consciousness, then there is a flow of that contamination into us, unless we are very strong. Invariably it happens that because of conditioning, if you are constantly in touch with somebody, the subtle body mixes. The subtle body, you cannot help. His thinking will mix with your thinking will mix with his thinking. Opinions, perceptions, all these things will mix. His feelings will mix with your feelings. And you can't be so sharp to filter which feeling of his I can allow it to mix. Which thinking, which understanding of his I can allow. Which kind of desires is I should keep away and I should think it is favorable. So continuously to be very alert, it is not easy. Because conditionally we don't filter when we associate with people. The lot of subtle things that happens between the two individuals when they associate. Not about one time association, you go on repeatedly associating, then that communication happens of the subtle energy. And that is exactly pulling down the consciousness, our chitta, which is getting purified day to day by chanting Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, it falls down to his level. So that is why it is said that we have to be very careful about executed under regulation. That means his association also with those who are contaminated consciousness, we go out to preach. And when we preach to them, we make sure that we preach to them and we don't get preached. The devotees also get preached by somebody. They should have firm conviction in Krishna consciousness and ensure that you preach and don't get preached. Now, not only the person preached by talking, the devotee sees the person's opulence, this, that, this, his rasa and all those things. You won't be filtering it. You'll quietly think he's a great guy. If you think he's a great guy, finished. He is completely in a consciousness of lording over. And if you think any materialist is a great guy, or even if you think he's greater than you, in terms of your consciousness, you are not realizing your good fortune of having got Krishna consciousness, your good fortune of having chanted 16 rounds today and going and seeing him. Where is a comparison of the good fortune of yours and that person's? So if at all we mingle with karmis, it should be only out of paradigm of compassion. On behalf of my spiritual master, whatever I have benefited, I just want to give whatever this person can take. Therefore, I am going. So that kind of alertness should be there when we go out as preachers. Another very important point that Prabhupada is touching upon in this purport is question of duplicity, being straightforward. Especially Prabhupada is saying straightforward with respect to self-interest. One should not be crooked. This crooked thinking is characteristic of lording tendency. First, I have an objective, how to manipulate this person. And then you make plans how to manipulate. This kind of thinking is not there in the spiritual world. This kind of thinking is not there in the pure mind. A pure mind does not have this kind of thinking. Not only about lording the living entity in a swarupa, gives respect to all living entities. You will not indirectly manipulate another living entity. Will not manipulate material energy, another living entity, for one's self-interest. So this self-interest is very, very important. One becomes a devotee only when he hands over his self-interest to the Lord. We have a body, so we all have something to be taken care. Let us call that as self-interest. Everybody has a need. Material need, spiritual need, all these things are there. And what is the mood of a devotee? Yes, I am completely dependent upon the Lord. I need so many things. But that is not my concern. My concern is to serve the Lord. The servant's concern is not how I will live, how I will survive. The servant's concern is master's pleasure. And the master's concern is to take care of the servant. This is a relationship with the devotee and the Lord as far as his self-interest is concerned. So when he knows that the Lord will take care, so for his own self-interest, he does not manipulate anybody. And there is another important statement that Prabhupada is making here, that to think of Vaishnava devotees as, okay. One should be without pride. One should not demand unnecessary respect from others. So why Prabhupada is saying unnecessary respect? Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, don't expect any respect. Prabhupada says, don't expect unnecessary respect. In this material world, our position is, we have taken up the position of preachers. That means we have taken up preaching mission. That means we have taken up preaching duties, which means we have taken up different roles, servant roles, for the sake of the mission of the Lord. When you have taken up servant roles, in order for you to perform that role as a servant, some necessary respect is required. Anything other than that is called unnecessary respect. So in service of the Lord, there is an exchange of respect, there's a need for a respect. Just like, let us say, a temple president. If there is no respect for the temple president, then the temple president cannot play the role of temple president. Is it not? So there is a role play as a servant of the Lord. So every devotee should respect other devotees, should give that due respect to their service roles. That means you are facilitating the preaching mission. And that is why it is, Prabhupada says, that should not demand unnecessary respect from others, because we are all not pure devotees still. When we are out of this world completely, then there is no question of, you know, any respect. We are not required. I am not doing any service, so why do I need respect? But in our case, it's the whole opposite. We don't do service and also we want respect. The pure devotees of the Lord, they don't want respect, but still they have to accept some respect, because I have to function. Just like, take the position of guru. Guru in his heart is thinking, I am the servant of my disciple. This disciple has been handed over to me by the Lord to be taken care. I am his servant. This is a guru's attitude. And he has to offer the disciple the feet of the Lord. Just like we offer some flowers and take that flowers and then you worship that flowers. Isn't it? We offer some flowers to the feet of the Lord, then you take that and keep it on our head. So guru's attitude is also like that. He keeps the disciple on his head, because his internal mood is that of, I am servant of my Lord. My disciple is my responsibility of my seva. Now tell me, this internal mood, can it be communicated to the disciple? No. Disciple should realize this, should realize the transcendental position of the spiritual master, the glorious position of the spiritual master. But this cannot be communicated, the guru cannot tell. Because the shishya needs to give respect as good as God to him. So it is his duty to train the shishya to develop devotion to Krishna. And the importance of telling how humble I have to be is not within the duty of the spiritual master. It is the duty of the spiritual disciple to understand the true glorious position of the spiritual master. So spiritual master teaches the disciples, just like Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur in one of his Vyas Puja, he says, ordinary people may be thinking, who is this big monkey sitting on a big asana and everybody is worshipping him? He does not want to be worshipped. But they all need to be learn how to worship. Disciples need how to give respect. Therefore, in order to teach people how to give respect, if you have to teach people how to give respects, if somebody is giving respect, somebody has to take respect also, no? Yes or no? Suppose the Vaishnava says, I won't take respect at all, but you have to learn how to give respect. Then devotee will be lost. Okay, the only people other available is karmis. How can I give respect to them? I have to learn how to give respect. Where will I apply my giving respect? Some Vaishnava has to receive. The Vaishnava is receiving the respect. Should not demand unnecessary respect from others. There's a necessary. What is the necessity? How much that person is required for his service to give respect. That respect you receive and pass it on to the Supreme Lord. So that is a very important, significant thing that Prabhupada says. One should not demand unnecessary respect from others. So due respect in devotional service of the Lord does not fall under the word pride. It does not come under pride. And we have to be very careful that it's not converted into pride. Any questions? Yes.
Master, so what efforts should the disciple put in order to understand the internal mood? Like, I want to understand what does Prabhupada want. So I would speculate that by reading his books I would understand, but what do you suggest? How do I understand the internal mood of the spiritual master without the spiritual master?
No, I already told what is internal mood. What is that to understand? The internal mood is, I am the humble servant of Krishna. That is his mood. His mood is not as a master at all. His mood for the sake of the service is, I am master. But he is not thinking he is master in his mood. He'll role play as a master. You see, just like you are real something, and in, you have a drama role. You may play a role. And you are always aware you are playing a role, but you are what you are, isn't it? Similarly, a pure spiritual master, a bona fide spiritual master, is very clear he is a servant of the servant of the servant of the disciple. I am training him as his servant. His mood is that. That is why you see Prabhupada's humility everywhere. This is Prabhupada's, just see, every other guru establishes their mission. Ramakrishna mission, this mission, that mission, their name. Prabhupada, International Society for Krishna Consciousness. He didn't say Prabhupada consciousness. Prabhupada mission, nothing. He said Krishna consciousness. More people know about ISKCON in this world than about Prabhupada. Yes? They know ISKCON, ISKCON, ISKCON. Prabhupada? That is how he glorified Krishna. Now it is our duty to glorify Prabhupada. It is not Prabhupada's work to glorify himself. It is our duty. That duty is left to us to glorify such a pure devotee, to glorify the humility of such a pure devotee who has zero lording tendency. Serving, 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 serving his spiritual master.
Hare Krishna.
Last question.
When we hear karmis, so it is affecting our consciousness, we become contaminated by hearing them.
Hearing their ideas.
Hearing their ideas.
By hearing the sound and nothing.
Okay. So how to understand this principle of first you become a good listener, then you will become a good speaker?
That is the difficulty with the seminars. Everything that you hear in this karmi seminars is you take with a pinch of salt. You should know how to use it. Okay, first thing, they themselves teach you that listening is not agreeing. That means your internal voice is very alert. You may listen. Listen is only an input stage. I am not agreeing. When you are listening, somebody will think, oh, he is quietly listening. That means he is agreeing. In the social interaction, the social discourse, normally this is the defense mechanism. So you won't allow that person to talk because I don't want to give him an impression that I am agreeing with him. If I sit quiet, that means I am agreeing with him. So you'll give back. So it's a sattvaguna actually to listen. No problem. Bolo, kuch bhi bolo. Pura sunenge. Shanti se sunenge. So it's a very good application. So you listen. Because unless you hear the other person, you are not knowing what you are dealing with. You have to know the current reality, what the other person is thinking. To know what the other person is thinking, you have to have in your mind this, you know, to hold your opinion, but at the same time to pick up how and why he is thinking. Without you making his thinking as your thinking. So that is very important to understand. Then only you can find out, hey, this is your logic is wrong. You have to understand his logic. Your logic is wrong. You cannot correct a person unless you listen. If that is our duty to correct somebody. Okay. When you come to karmis, they listen to them. That is about different opinions. Suppose the person is started talking about, I have this problem, I have that problem, you know, this thing happened, that thing happened, my wife, this, then my children, this, all those things, I have in a very serious problem, all this. So that listening has got an emotional layer. Correct? Now you should listen by cutting off the emotional layer. Otherwise, you are not helping him. You are also going into that. So this is another mistake that when we hear about empathic listening. In seminars they teach you empathic listening. Empathic listening means we should feel their feelings. Right? You should feel their feelings. It actually means you should understand their feelings. Not that you become their feelings and then you are also in the same way. He is depressed, you also become depressed. He is telling you so that you pull him out of depression. So you don't identify with those things. So these are some of the things you have to be very careful while listening. Of course, generally one should not. You should very frankly tell, "Hum to ye sab chhod diya." आप भी छोड़ने के आए तो आ जाइए. He is in a well and he is trying to pull you into the well. And sometimes devotees, they don't understand. Ah, really, 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 really. One day, 2 days, 3 days, and he comes back to ashram, then he is thinking, oh, he is so sad, how to help him. Finish, you are gone. You gave everything up. You gave up your family, you gave up your family, house problem, everything. When you heard Sarvadharman Parityajya, Maam Ekam Sharanam Vraja, and you surrendered. And that time the parents' problem, house problem, this problem, everything, chod diya, aagaya. Or cut off all the emotional layers. And then after some days you come here, one donor is telling his story, you are fallen into his katha. We want Krishna Katha. We don't want this Manishya Kathas. Grandharachimad Bhagavatam ki jai, Jagat Guru Srila Prabhupada ki jai.